Hey, we're Barry Tomorrow, and we're going to have a little natter about how we wrote and recorded our sixth album, Cannibal. So I think really it started like what? There were songs there that were in, you know, their early phases, not long after we recorded Black Flame, I think it's fair to say. I guess how it always starts is just I'll go home, come up with some riffs and like basic song structures, and then start sending them around and we all get a feel for them, let them sit for a bit, and then decide where we want to go from there.
Yeah, you always, I think you all do, to be fair, but you always get way more interested before me. I procrastinate about new material for ages and then do it when, like, give a shit when I really, really need to give a shit. But you always, by the time that I'm coming to it, you've always got at least like six songs worth of something, and you know Dan's already listened to one or two and got a real idea of vocals for some certain bits. So
I feel like this one we're in like two phases. I remember I'd like six songs, as you say, and then for a bit of change of scenery I came to you for like a week, hardly slept and just ripped loads of, took songs apart like we never have before. I think this is the most we ever wrote.
That's always the last few records we've done, I'm a really big fan of, like, I think it's a good way of getting everybody's input as well, is to think it's not the finished article as quickly as possible, if that makes sense. So we just wanted to rejig everything almost for the sake of rejigging it, and that was a big part of you coming down to me for a couple of weeks, was just kind of taking everything that we think we liked and changing it for the sake of it and seeing if we came up with something better.
I've been a devil's advocate for every
song.
Yeah,
and that's not even like specific parts. If we had to write a specific part for that, we would. But it was more transitions, and it was more where things went and how things flowed and how songs ended and how songs began and all of that stuff. Because I think once you get that DNA of the song, and you have, because we're big believers of like one riff is all you need, you
100%
know? One riff is all you need to create something, to create a song. So we normally it's more with this record, it was more about where do we put that riff and how do we make that riff a million other things in the same song. Mm-hmm. How do we there was a lot of different mindsets going into it.
Yeah, I know what you're saying though, because there's certain like lead lines that we took out of certain songs and then put them in others. For example, the lead from Cannibal was initially the start to Imposter, and that became Cannibal.
Yeah, and a big one of this was like off the bat straight away. I was really vocal with Dawson about keeping the choruses as simple and as stripped back as possible, and it was just a case of like I wanted the blankest canvas for choruses as I could have, so they had the legs. The likelihood to have legs to go as far as they could, as far as, I don't know, just being great. So, yeah, that was something conscious, and I felt that we did that better than we'd ever done it before.
I think again though, from like even your writing standpoint, there were a lot more care took into the creation of melodies. There were so many more. You basically wrote two melodies that we were almost getting comfortable with before we decided on a final actual chorus.
Yeah, well, a good example is I always remember you coming up to hear The Grey, and you were like, please tell me you haven't changed this chorus, and I completely changed it to what it is now, and you were like, oh no, and then you heard it and you were like, oh snap, that's cool.
So yeah, I think with mindset wise, it's like, certainly for myself, me and Dorse spend a lot of time right at the start of the whole process of like with the same mindset that it's not a finished article, and that, you know, it's all about everyone's input and changing that. But actually we spend a lot of time together, certainly in that first writing process, just kind of batting ideas off each other, where the song could go, what it could start to kind of feel vocally. But then also having the precursor that we knew, again, we wanted to do a lot of pre-production on this record again and rip songs apart in a formalised kind of way. And so it's really just an elongated kind of pre-production. We almost get a song down quite quickly on base level and the DNA, as Jay said, but then we kind of point then rip it to shreds for the next two, three
it's
months.
It's natural, because, you know, because you write the drums as well, it's natural to get to a position with a demo very quickly that is, as you say, is essentially done if you want it to be done. And to be honest with you, like, from a riff point of view, from like those catchy riffs that you start most songs with, a lot of that is where you would base around your vocal or something same. So it kind of, that stuff doesn't normally tend to change. The thing that will change is where we put it. It'll be
And it really helps that Dorse loves lyrics and vocals and catch lines as well, because then we kind of back that that understanding of, like, you could stick a great catch line there, you could stick a great part in there, and he writes around that.
I was going to say, I definitely feel like we've, especially since Earthbound, we've really got, you know,
you're into a groove around how we write vocals.
I think a big part of the writing process, and I know this for you as well, Dawson, is, and it's for all of us, is it's really, and every time we do a new record, it's always a battle, but I think a battle that we always win is just the trust and the confidence in yourself. You know, when you're writing a sixth one, it's very easy to think, well, A, have all my great ideas been like run dry, sort of thing? And you think you've just got to back yourself and back. And that's what we did pretty early on with this one. We weren't worried if a song seemed maybe more simpler than stuff we've done before. We just kind of trusted our focus, I guess.
I think leading on to that, I think some of it is a lot simpler than what we've done before. But then again, there is also some really challenging moments, especially riff-wise, but... talking from a purely like guitar-based standpoint here, there's a lot. I'd say there's a lot less work that's been, you know, a lot less solos, to be honest. But I feel like
even from
it's,
a rhythm,
it's just serving the song. At the end of the day, we have gone out as a way to create something a bit different for Bury Tomorrow here. But I think it does suit, you know, where we've gone with album. It's a much darker record musically, and that's something that, you know, we did do intentionally, to be honest.
As Jay said, it's that if you back yourself, then you're not going to be constantly trying to show off every element of your music. You serve the song and what the song needs.
Or like, the album, you know, in this case.
And then when we obviously, we get to a point where the song is pretty much, we're happy with it. You know, I lyrically usually have loads of lyrics anyway, as far as I'm always writing catch lines and lyrics and stuff. And then I start writing around the demos, around some of the pre-productions, obviously edit it as and when the songs are ripped apart or edited and move them around and change them and all that kind of stuff. And then what I tend to do is start getting thematically where I want the albums to go. That generally is the standard process. And then, because obviously then you have majority around what the album is going to be about. All of our albums aren't, you know, overarching massive themes, but this one then specifically got to a point where it was like six songs that were predominantly around a similar point.
Well, I kind of feel like because this album became obviously very quickly about your own personal issues and what you've been going through, it was never really a conscious decision, was it? It kind of just happened.
Like, and we had the only conversation I just remember is like coming to the guys and understanding, like, yeah, I've written seven songs here, guys, that are all about a really similar thing. And then the guys just being like, if we're going to do this, let's just do it wholeheartedly. Like, there's no point being half in, half out. And actually, that's part of it, is that understanding that, like, if you're going to do something, you do it properly. And that was where the only conscious decision was a discussion around, actually, do we change that?
In a weird sort of way, me and Dan are very... we're very separate in our approaches. I'd say you more so with this campaign because of what it's about, but we're normally very separate in our approaches and very me. I isolate myself with my ideas and I isolate myself with my thoughts when thinking about singing. But then we both, obviously, we come together and then we both come together with Dawson to kind of merge it all together, which is probably the best way of explaining it. In a weird sort of way. Like, I would say me and you, Dan, normally have a lot more conversation about lyrics and song meanings, whereas this one was so obvious straight away where we were coming from, what we were doing. We didn't really need to have a
conversation. No, it was actually really nice. It was a really nice, weird process this time, because it was very much a, you know, these are what the songs are about. You know, you knew what the songs were about, certainly in a general speak, but then actually turning around on it, it was then is this what it feels like? Is this how you felt? Are these lyrics right? Do they sit, you know, right with that? And that was a really nice process, actually, because it was nice to actually see that 99.9% of them were bang on with where I was mentally in that time.
I think I texted you saying, mate, are you going to send me any happy are you going to send me any happy lyrics? And you text me back going, no.
I turned one. I was like, I've turned it. This one's kind of happy. And so then you're like, okay. No, it's not.
It's cool, though. I do think that the music and the lyrics really do complement each other to truly give off what this album is about. in both aspects.
Yeah, you need the music. You need the music to sing what the lyrics are saying, because otherwise it sounds like a juxtaposition. I mean, some artists, you know, you go and someone like Morrissey or the Smiths, and that actually is their niche, is that actually they are so wildly different. I think for us and metal, there is something inherently emotive about instrumental side of it as well, like the power that you can have from the heavy parts, the melody and the juxtaposition between melody and heaviness is a beautiful thing that we have the ability to do. And then you couple that with lyrics, you only need to listen to like The Grey, for example, which to really feel how a song can be transformed when those two come together.
And I would have said, by taking a more simplistic approach musically, as you said at the start of this conversation, it all just feels like unintentionally somehow it all became
it's really cohesive
what it is.
So
yeah, quite an organic, yet not at all times organic process, but it just feels as a body of work that it all came together for the right reasons. And
hitting the right message, you know, that's what we're about with this record, is that it lands well not only with the fans of our music, but also people that wanted to understand a bit more about
invested in us as people.
Yeah, and like us as people, and wanted to understand, you know, in a bit more about my mentality and where I was, and that feeling, and it connects us, which is a really nice thing that we can do on this record.
Personally, I felt like some of the songs did come from quite an honest place in regards to that as well. Not to go off on a tangent there, but I definitely had my own little struggles throughout the start of this, and it kind of translated musically, as I feel that as a musician it's important to kind of speak through your music in some kind of way, without sounding too much of an artiste. But it's true, I wanted to, you know, evoke some emotions from the music.
Yeah.
But I think musically inspiring what we come up with, it can vary from anything. I do like putting Game of Thrones on. There were certain periods of this time I'd put Game of Thrones on mute and just write music whilst that was on, you know, looking at images and just like trying to conjure like certain melodies from what you're seeing, and just taking different approaches. Sometimes I could be in a movie, or, you know, Aladdin, for example, and be like, you'd hear something and it'd spark something.
But it's also, there's a level of like, we also tour, you know, we tour with bands that are at the top of their game. We play with people and see people in different kind of derivatives of our kind of genre doing amazing things, you know. So I would be lying if we didn't take influence, and have done for the past 15 years, albeit some of those bands aren't a thing anymore or around. And it's from anything. It can be a local band, or it could be our friend's band, or it can be a band that's playing 50,000 capacity places that we just take a bit of influence from what they're doing, right? And it's about, all it is for us is about maintaining our style and having our finger on the pulse of where metal music is and where, you know, what journey that's on. It's not about changing our style, but it's nodding to what our fans, we want, what we think that they want to hear.
Well, I actually think that's very natural. I think we as five people just create a sound that sounds like we do, you know, and that kind of puts us in our own bubble. But to go back to like the inspiration thing, and like musically, I know that me and Dawson had a lot of discussions whilst we were really getting into the record just at the end of the summer, wasn't it? About songs that we loved in metal, but also not in our genre, that stood the test of time.
I think we made a bit of a playlist,
yeah,
did we not?
And it was about listening to songs that were released 20 years ago in our genre, but still get listened to now, no matter what. And we listened to System, we listened to Rage, we listened to a lot of bands that weren't necessarily like cool metal right now, but have stood the test of time, because that's something that we really want to do. We want our albums to be listenable in 20, 30 years.
You are right. I do remember tanning corn when writing The Grey, for example. Like, there were certain aspects.
Whereas
I think
on other records, we might have listened to our older albums to find inspiration. We might have listened to our peers to find inspiration. This time, I mean, we've got to the point all personally where we don't listen to what our fans listen to anymore. Like, it's just, you know, we don't listen to like Architects every day, we don't listen to Parkway every day. We're not there anymore.
No.
We've kind of matured with our music taste to a point where we like what we like, and that's kind of it now, you know. So I think it's hard to find inspiration off what's around you, but we try to delve back into history and kind of take things that we've loved from bands that are doing stuff that we want to do, you know, we want to be around in 20 years, we want to still be making music, we want to do this for the rest of our lives if we can. And the bands that have done that have a real Well, the bands that have done that, that we love their music, you know, and we love their music, they've got, there's definitely a real, I don't know, what's the word, like, concoction.
Yeah, it's of, like a formula, isn't it?
Yeah, there's definitely a formula. And we've tried to, I guess we've tried to, like, do our own sort of hacking of that formula.
Just staying true to what we like and what we got into this for, but whilst also trying, not trying, but just, you know, appealing to our fans as well. So it's just, yeah, just having a generally honest approach to it all.
Yeah, definitely. And then I guess like melody and like, as I said before, I'm really, I isolate myself when it comes to doing my vocals, just because I don't know why I do that, but I just,
it
I
works.
Like to, yeah, I like to, I've always done it. I think once you do something once or twice and it works, you're very like,
it's like going to Subway. Yeah, you know, like, you're signing.
Not going to break it if it don't need fixing. So that's my tack. But inspirational wise, I've always been really inspired by pop music, really. Pop music and melodic metal, like European melodic metal, like Soilwork and certain heavy bands that have a lot of different sort of vocals going on, not just singing but screaming as well, and then all this other crazy stuff that screamers are doing now, where they're kind of singing but they're kind of not, you know. I like all that stuff and I like the dynamic of it, and I try and put that into everything I do. So yeah, I'm also a big fan of pop music. It's not even like I'm a big fan of pop music, I just really like good singers and great melodies. And so I try and put that into metal, because I don't think in metal music there's a lot of facade, and I think there's a lot of people that don't want to do things that certain genres will do because it's not metal. And you know, if me and the boys sit in a room and play music, we're a metal band. There's no getting around that. That's the way we sound when we all get together and we play our songs. So I've never been worried about losing that identity vocally, because we're metal. Like, and as long as you're here, Dan, we're always going to be seen as a really heavy band. So it kind of frees me up to really delve into, like, Sia, for example. I've listened to a lot of Sia. I mean, I listen to a lot of Sia. I've probably got the same influences as I did on Black Flame, really, for this one. Same, like, I kind of have been through the same process listening to the same sort of music, so I went into it in a similar way. But that's really vocally where it's at with me.
I think musically speaking, the Grey went through quite a few changes, but developing, it's just the simplistic nature of that song and how it hits emotionally, at least speaking from seeing it played live. I'm really proud of how that came out. I think your vocals in that song are some of the heaviest that you've ever done.
They are.
And I think some of your actual lyrical content is, you know, I want the rock from my bones to feed the trees.
Yeah,
it's quite poetic. But yeah, also, I mean, you had a few melody changes to that, and I think it is quite a different song for us, man, and seeing how it all came out is, I'm very proud of that. But also, Dark Infinite was quite a sporadic song. That was initially going to be a bonus track. I can remember.
I think it's fair to say that and I mean, maybe we do, but we really don't. When we're in the studio, and when we're writing, but when we're in the studio, there really isn't anyone's personal agenda. Like, none of us have like an agenda that we're kind of like, this is what I want and I want to get it over the line. Like, it's weird.
True.
It's
almost
like, no, like, I don't want to do anything unless the four of you are stoked on it too. Like, it's we've got to this weird point where. Yeah, I mean, it's good, obviously, but we just, I'm trying to think, like, what did I think, over the line?
I think the only thing I could say from vocally is that from a technical standpoint, I used a handheld mic on this record, and that was really, really weird and a different experience, but looking back now, I wouldn't change anything on that, because it's really brought to life, I think. The only thing I can attribute to some of the more emotive parts on the record, some of the more vocalizations that aren't just straight screaming, are completely down to using that handheld mic. So it was a real moment of being like, do we back something that's really different, or do we do what we do because we've got five records that say that is the way to do it and they sound good? And that was a really a testing point, really, and it worked. You know, it was one of those really, really nice, proud moments where you go, just try something different, see if it works, and it worked. And it was just it wasn't, you know, obviously if it hadn't have worked and we'd have reflected on it, we'd have changed back to the old mic and we'd have done the usual thing. But actually, it was a really nice moment, actually, to be like, you know what, this sounds great. You know, I didn't have a lot of faith in that it would sound better than what we've had previously, and it mm. did. So, and that was a conscious decision myself, which was again really nice to have that, because usually it's a producer that says, you know, that's what you're going to use. Does that sound good for you? Do you want to change it out? And you just generally go with what you have. But that was a moment where I was like, I want to be handheld. I want to make sure that it sounds decent. And it worked, you know, and it got a lot of the emotion across the line, which I'm proud of.
I would definitely back that sentiment, especially in Quake, which is a completely different song for us. I think for all three of us sat here, to be honest, you can really tell, basically. And as you deliver those like final lines, all you'll see is red. You can truly hear that aggression.
I
feel is, you know, really demonstrated from the use of technology that we decided to go for.
Yeah, and it's not a usual process, is it? You know, it's sometimes quite an uncomfortable, not for us now, not five albums that we were doing stood up, SM9 stuff, but it was like a going back to when you're back first recording a demo and you're running around the studio, which was just a really odd thing, surreal moment to have, really. But you know, it was a conscious decision predominantly because a lot of the conversations I have about my vocals live and my vocals on record is that actually there's a slight difference there, and you know, you can only really attribute that to being comfortable, and that was what it was. It was, albeit everything else wasn't comfortable, going through every line 26 times with Jace and Dan and us ripping through it and really getting the best out of me, but it wouldn't have been as easy of a process. It would have been a lot harder if it wasn't on the handheld, because I think it would have been quite uncomfortable and punishing, whereas it felt live that I could do it and I was comfortable in that setting, because that's what we do predominant parts of a year.
You know,
predominantly we'll tour and then do an album every year and a half.
It's probably worth saying actually that I am a bit of a control freak. So like with the studio, like I definitely didn't need to, but I went down for the whole thing, and I like to be there for everything. And I like to give my opinion on pretty much
everything
that people do. But someone's got to oversee.
Well, it gets the best out of us.
Someone's got to oversee, right? But yeah, I mean, it really is a comfortable process for me, and even the pressures that we all have a lot of pressure on each of us to kind of step up and do something that we maybe haven't done before, as you say, like get something over the line that we're super proud of that maybe we haven't shown off before. Mm-hmm. And you've got all those things flying around, and I think you do need one person there, kind of one person there just with that one perspective that everybody can trust and come back to. Mm-hmm. Which I feel like we had that with this one.
I think also
in the last couple, probably.
I suppose another personal perspective proud of is the thematics of the record. You know, this is the first time I've ever been really blatant about, you know, personal situations, mental health, all that kind of stuff, and you know, and the connections that I've had already over the tracks that we've released are a really positive one for that. And I think that it was a big, not a risk, because I think we took a calculated risk, if you will, as far as we're in a great position to be able to do that kind of thing off the back of Black Flame and personally being as well as I am now. Like, but the ability to take that risk and it pay off is a really great thing.
When it's an organic thing, dude, it's
yeah,
not
it
a
was,
risk.
Yeah.
When it's a natural thing, it isn't a risk, mate. It's just something that happens. Like we it really wasn't a decision that we made, and if it was, then there's a risk involved, because we didn't decide to do it, and it was just an organic natural thing that kind of just, you, as I said, you hit me up, I'm texting you going, bro, you're gonna send me something happy.
Yeah.
And you're like, no, and I'm like, okay. And then that's the thing, as I said before, we never really had that conversation. There was never like a proper, well, maybe not with me anyway, I never really had that. It was almost kind of like, okay, like, and as I said before, it kind of, in many ways, just from a writing point of view, it just made it easier for us. Like, it just made everything a bit easier.
I think the only thing that I had, as I said before, was more of a me being conscious, because I'm the only one that had to be overtly conscious about what I was saying, I suppose.
Yeah.
And also that this is a band of five equal parties, you know, five people, that this record is their record as much as it is mine, and it is on a thematical point of view around a personal situation. It was actually, you know, it's a record of five people, so I had to be conscious and kind of say, guys, we're writing 11 tracks about my depreciated mental health over the past 2.5 years.
But we as a four would ever
Yeah, but it's only going to ever go one way.
Yeah,
it?
So there's never a conversation where the four of us are like, and you know, like it gets to that point, I think, when you've been in the band for as many years as we have, we understand that we're very conscious anyway that, you know, whatever we do personally, even in our own lives, reflects on the rest of the guys. There's an opinion of Barry tomorrow when one of us does something. So I think because we're so conscious of that anyway, it would have been super quick. You would have known super quickly if it was an uncomfortable thing going forward. And I like to think that the four of us and all five of us bandied around really quickly together.
Yeah, absolutely.
To kind of just be like, this is where he's going with this sort of thing.
And, yeah, and actually the only thing that happened was the opposite of, like, you know, like the commitment that it does take to do a cycle around this. And that was the conversations we had of, like, you know what, like, you've just got to look at, and I remember it, yourself, Dav, you, Dawes, like, we had the conversation.
Yeah,
like,
we're worried about
look after yourself, like, because you're going to be talking about this left, right and centre, and I think there's that trust, again, in my resilience at the time to be like, no, it's okay, guys, I got this, and that was it, really.
Yeah.
There was no...
Well, it was just a case of making sure, and obviously it's not, it was just a case of making sure that you knew that we knew that this was a personal process for you individually.
Definitely.
This wasn't there is no pressure as far as selling records. This is a natural process for you, and it will only ever go the way you want it to go as far as how deep we delve and how deep we don't delve. And that was the same, I think, lyrically, and that's probably why there was probably definitely a case of when I was writing my lyrics, there was a case of, like, I read every single one of your words and I was making sense of every single one of your words. So I was like, okay,
this is what it feels like.
Yeah, and I was like, okay, you kind of explained what you were going through and what it, bleh, it basically reading your lyrics and writing my own was the conversation we needed.
Which
is when we're, and but say we were writing a song about the beach down the road, we'd have to have a conversation about that to really get on the same.
But I feel like, you know, in regards to getting stuff off the line or, you know, just doing something different, I do feel like, to summarise, maybe musically, that Quake really does deliver that, everything that we've just been talking about. It's not about necessarily getting something over the line, but doing something different, and I feel like that's the embodiment of this particular topic that we've just discussed. I feel like Quake really does.
Yeah, well, I remember sitting at mine with you with a whiteboard, and I remember in the course of about 3-4 hours we completely changed what Quake was and then changed it back again, didn't we? We completely changed it.
The only thing that stayed the same was initially that the motif, if you will.
Yeah, we basically, like, let's get rid of this and get rid of this and do this and do this and almost make it like a we almost went from making it what it was to a journey song where it started here and it ended here. So it wasn't, but then we kind of, I think the more we listened to what we already had, we realised that it was doing the parts in the song a bit of a disjustice. And I think, and this is the good thing about the almost accidental way that we kind of work, is because you and Dan put so much effort in at the very beginning, before I'm probably interested, you get things done that affect what me and you are doing later down the line massively. Because if that chorus wasn't the way it was with Dan, with his ideas and his words, I mean, you already had the lyrics, didn't you? If it wasn't like that, then we probably would have changed the song for the worst for the wrong reasons.
Yeah, there'd be more of a frantic,
didn't have that perspective.
And there'd be more of a frantic process towards the latter part of the writing, you know.
Because you just overthink it, dude. You overthink songwriting. It's almost impossible not to.
Yeah, it's an absolute nightmare.
Yeah.
But yeah, ultimately, we got everything.
Got everything over the line.
Yeah,
we
got everything over the line.
Yeah, we did it, guys.
Yeah, we smashed it.
We finished it.